Today we will continue on chapter two about forecasting and finalize that topic. And we will also start on chapter three, which is about aggregate planning. And of course, remember assignment number one, deliver it today or by 8 o'clock tomorrow morning, because I will check the deliveries when I come to work tomorrow. And then I will hopefully within a few days give you some simple comments back and present a solution for the assignment on Frontier, which I will also will present shortly on the next lecture next Wednesday. Before we start on chapter two and forecasting, I will go through the problems on assignment number two, which you have 3 weeks to complete. It's also uploaded in Frontier a few days ago. Here, this information will be the general information, which is the same as on assignment one, except that this one will also count for the final grade of the course, 10%, and similar for assignment three. So each of the assignments will count for 10%, and the final exam will count for 80% of the grade in the course. And you will be graded by percentage, and the final percentage will be converted to letter grade A to F after the exam is completed. So publish date or presentation date at least today, and the submission date by Wednesday in 3 weeks. And the first problem is about forecasting. And now we have seasonal series. Most of you have already finished assignment number one. The others hopefully will do it today, but you will find out that regression will probably not be a good forecasting method in this particular situation, where you're talking about a product, the Nintendo GameCube, which obviously is a very common Christmas gift and is sold much more in November and December than the rest of the year. So this is a typical seasonal product. And then a linear regression method, like we have seen in the regression analysis, which only looks at the trend, will not give a very good forecast when you look into the future, at least for a long time into the future, because the line will continue to increase, and you will have, you will have seasonal differences in every year. So what you should do here is to use a method called Winter's method, which I will present today, just after I finished going through the problems here. You have to use this method, Winter's method, which is a method which both considers a trend, increasing or decreasing trend, and also seasonal differences. You should use data, the same data as you have used in problem number or assignment number one for this Nintendo GameCube product, and create a model and forecast the demand for all months of 2004 by using data from 2002 and 2003, and show the value of the mean absolute deviation for the forecast of 2004. And then you should use what we have called the smoothing constant, alpha, beta, and gamma, which has a value of 0.1. And update estimates of the series, the gradient, and the seasonal factors for each month in 2004 when the demand of the previous month is known. So here you will start and initialize the method by using data from 2002 and 2003. And then in problem B, you have to update every month. January, you get new data, you need to update the model. February, again. March, April, and so on. For every month in 2004, you have to update the model according to the current demand. When each time you get a new demand, you need to update the model and find new values. And then compare the forecast for 2004 made at the end of 2003 which is problem number A, to the forecast updated for each month, which is problem B, and then give some comments to the results. First, in A, you should make a forecast for the full year with the data you have at the end of 2003, and in B, update for every month and only forecast 1 month ahead. And then in D, what would happen if the forecast from B, if the smoothing constant was changed to 0.2? They start with a value of 0.1, and now what would happen if this constant is increasing? Similar, what would happen if there was changed to 0.05? So you have to make an analyze of what will happen when you change the value of this smoothing constant. And as we remember from methods for single and double exponential smoothing, the smoothing constants will give the importance of the last measured value or the last data put into the model compared to the last forecast in the model. And this is the same for Winter's method, which is a what we call a triple exponential smoothing model. And then you have three different values of the smoothing constant: 0.05, 0.1, and 0.2, and give a comment to the result. Then go back to the value of 0.1, show a graph with the values of the gradient during 2004. And what can we conclude about the demand for this product by looking at the graph? You remember the gradient will give how much the trend line is increasing or eventually decreasing. And you should now look at this value during 2004. Of course, when you update month for month, as you do in problem B, and then make some comment. An answer, what can we conclude about the demand by looking at the graph? And then in F, use the data available by the end of 2004 to make a forecast for 2005. And the data available by the end of 2004 is what you actually have found in December in problem B. Because you have updated and updated and updated for every month in 2004, and then you have values for all the relevant values for the model in December 2004, and these values are what to be used in problem number F, to make a forecast for 2005, and show also here the MAD for the forecast and comment on the result. I have also uploaded the Excel sheet, which actually contains the same data, but here they are organized. First, the year 2002 and 3, which should be the basis for the model. Then 2004, which you should use in problem A and B, and compare to the forecast, and also in problem B, update the forecast by adding 1 month at a time. And at last, 2005, which you should compare against in problem number F. But the data, these values, are exactly the same as what you had in problem number one on the similar data set. Then problem two is about aggregate planning. This is chapter three, so I will go fast through it because we need maybe some theory before you can start on this one. But we will learn and see solutions on the same aggregate planning example using three different strategies. One strategy here is called the chase demand or the zero inventory demand, which is a strategy used to minimize the inventory on stock. You should not produce more than exactly what is needed in every period. And the periods are here the six first month of a year. Problem number two, or the second solution here, the second type of strategy, is what we call a constant workforce solution. It's another strategy which, instead of trying to minimize the inventory, is trying to make a feasible plan and with a constant workforce. So you should, at the start of the period, you should need to find out how many people do you need to employ to be able to meet the demand in the forecast for this month there. And then these people has to be employed for the full period. You're not able to change the workforce. That's also why the name is constant workforce. And number three is a solution by linear programming, which is an optimization, a type of optimization problem, which we can find what is the optimal. This is usually will be a combination or something between the two extreme strategies of zero inventory and constant workforce. You might be able to employ some people in peak periods, in March, for example, and May, where you have a very high demand here, or at least a very high forecast. You might be able to take some seasonal workers and get rid of them after the period. But still, this linear programming is an optimization problem, which is actually able to find the optimal, the solution which will give you the minimum cost overall. So here you have three different strategies, and you should try on this example, try to make up a production plan on all these three strategies. You're given the forecast and you assume that the forecast is correct. And you also are given a number of production days in each of these months. And you're given some additional information here about history. You produced 125,000 last year and you had 250 working days and on average 1,000 employees working every day. So looking at these sub-problems, you start with 1,000 workers. You have a stock on 2,000 units of inventory, which means that you might not need to produce a total of 8,000 because you already have 2,000 at the start of the period. And you here also want to plan with a stock of exactly 2,000 at the end of the planning period. So even if you have a forecast of only 7,000 here, you should plan so you have 2,000 units on stock when the period is over. You're given information here about the cost of hiring, the cost of firing, and also the cost of storing one unit of inventory in 1 month, since the periods here are given in month. So first, use the chase or the zero inventory strategy and find a production plan. Then the other so-called extreme strategy, constant workforce, make another production plan by this strategy. And then we should start on the optimization problem called a linear programming problem and explain the constraint sets to be used in such a model and make an LP, linear programming formulation of the problem, and solve that one using the program of Lingo. Lingo is a computer program used for optimizing such problems as this linear programming model for this particular problem. And then some analyze here, what is the differences of costs, structural differences and so on. And then the remaining problems here is to do some changes to the LP model and solve it in Lingo. First, a theoretical question about explain situation where you have a large holding cost compared to, no, large hiring cost compared to firing people or storing inventory. And then the large firing cost compared to the others. And at last, a large inventory cost, large cost of storing inventory compared to the cost of changing the workforce. So here, the remaining problems, use Lingo, do some changes to the model and try to solve it and discuss the actual results. I will go through some theory on linear programming problems, probably not today, but next Wednesday. And then you should be able, I will just first show this PowerPoint file, which is an introduction to Lingo, how to start. And this is a program which you can download to your own computer, but it's also installed on the computers on the students student lab in the computer labs in the A building. So there the Lingo program is already installed. This producer is called Lindo with a D, but the program is called Lingo with a G. And here you can find a trial solution which is more than sufficient for our use in this course. But this document, which is also uploaded in Fronter, will give an instructions on how to download a trial version. I think there are newer, this is 13, I think it is actually 15 is the newest version, but anyway, the old versions are more than good enough for solving our problems. So you can find a trial version here, download it to your own computer, or use some of the student computers on the computer labs. So here, some limitations with the demo version or the trial version, which we will use, and a very simple model. This LP, linear programming, is maximization or minimization problem. Find the optimal value, maximize some income or minimize the cost, for example, and given some restrictions here. So you need to maximize this function such that this constraints here is valid, that this formula should be less than or equal to 200 and so on. And to solve the model, you should pull this button here, formed like a bullseye. Also, when you make the pointer here, you will also see solve. So this is the way, try to write the model like this to a given structure in this program and solve it by pushing this button. So I will come back to more examples. But also here you will get a solution which says that the objective value, the optimal solution of this problem, is 1740, and the values of the parameters are given here. So we'll come back to this Lingo program and the LP problems probably next week, at least today I will be able to finalize the curriculum about forecasting and also start on the curriculum on chapter 3 about aggregate planning. So we have seen this figure before. I will go through the main parts again, quite short, because we have seen this purely random demand where you have no, you cannot find any trends or any system here. It's more or less random if you are going upwards or downwards, but you are able in such a pattern like this to find the average value, which is what you can expect to sell or can expect the demand to be for the coming period. You will have an average and you will have some kind of deviation from the average in every new period. And when you have so-called stationary series like this, we have seen a method called the moving average and another one called the exponential smoothing, which is able to make a forecast based on a stationary series when you cannot recognize any pattern at all. We have also seen methods for using or increasing, in this case, a linear trend, or identifying a trend and trying to use the trend line, the gradient, or the expected increase from period to period, and to make forecast into the future, assuming that this trend will continue. And also sometimes, or usually when you get new data, you should be able to do some adjustments to the trend, because when you get low demand in one period, you should be able to reduce the gradient of the trend line. So here, for this trend-based method, we have seen the regression analysis, which you used in assignment number one, and also you have seen Holt's method, which is related to the exponential smoothing, but called the double exponential smoothing, since it's also including the trend and the adjustments to the trend when you get new data. And we have seen some methods on the seasonal patterns. We have seen the first method called the simple method, or the quick and dirty method on the slides, which actually do not include a trend. It assumes that you have a stationary series, but you have seasonal differences among the stationary series or the horizontal line. We have seen a method called the N period moving average, which also in its basic form uses a stationary series and seasonal differences among a horizontal line, but we can identify a trend by de-seasonalizing the data and use some of the trend-based methods like regression or Holt's method to create or find the de-seasonalized series and then re-seasonalize it again by using the seasonal factors. So here, by using the N period moving average, it is possible to combine a seasonal method with a trend method and get both trends and seasons in the forecasting method. And what we will now present, which also is the method you should use in problem number one in assignment two, it's Winter's method, which is a method based on the exponential smoothing, and it's also called triple exponential smoothing. It is related to Holt's methods, method which we have seen for trends, but now we include one more topic, which is the season. So we have both trends and season included in the same method. So we will then assume that we have a demand or a pattern which looks like this figure here. You have a trend, either increasing or decreasing, but at least you have some development over time for the product. So we assume that we have an increasing line here, which will represent the trend. And then we have seasonal differences around this trend line, looking more like this. And if we now assume that we are on this point, we can identify this point here, which is called the S point, the value of the series, which is the non-seasonal value of the series at the current point. This is the end point of the trend line, which should not be confused by this point, which is the last data point, the measured data point in the last or the current period. And in this case, you have a season which where you sell more than you actually expect to do according to only looking at the trend line. Because you have a season, this might be the summer season where you are selling more products of your more of your particular product. But in the winter season, you might not sell that much, as you can see in this figure here. The S value represent the end point of the trend line and should not be confused by the last data point. This will now be the D value, the data point for the last measured data. And we also need to identify what we call the G, which is the gradient of the trend line, how much the trend will increase or decrease, will change from one period to the next one. This is similar to what we saw in Holt's method. You still had the S and the G and the series and the G, but what is new now by Winter's method is that you also have to include the seasonal factor, which tells you how much above or below the trend line you will assume that you will sell in this particular season or this particular period. So this Winter's method is based on a model looking like this, that the demand, and if we can include a hat there, the D hat, which means that this is not the actual demand, but it is the forecasted demand for one period, will be equal to what the book now denotes as the Greek letter mu, which is the base of the line excluded seasonality. So in this case, we are on period here, which might be period zero. Let's say that this is the current period. Everything on this part of the line will be history, and what is on this part will be the future, what we now want to predict. And when we should make a forecast for the next period, we have to continue the trend line at the same with the same gradient as we have calculated here, and we need to adjust the forecast by the seasonal factor. And this mu value will now be similar to, if this is now period number T, will be similar to what this trend line expect to be the basis for the next period here. So the mu value will be the base. Of course, it's not. The mu value will actually be here, the S value, the previous value of the trend line. And we need to add the gradient here. This will be more correct. So mu is the basis, what you actually have today, this point, plus the gradient, how much you expect to increase to the next period. And this should now be multiplied by C, which is the seasonal factor, which means that now we have been on a top season and we are going back into a low season. So we expect that we actually will end up here. The trend line says that you should have the base up here, but the seasonal factor says that you will not sell as much in this season or in this period because this is low season. And of course, for the model compared to the exact value, you also need to add some error term. So here you might add some error term, and then this one can be the exact value, because when you look back and compare the exact demand to what you had forecasted, you will usually experience that you have some differences. It's not easy to get exactly right when you are forecasting, because there are always some kind of uncertainties. So here, by looking at this example here, we will now try to define this model called Winter's method and start. And first we need to we will present the formulas, how to update this model, and then how to initialize it, because we need to start and get initial values. But when we get new data, we have a formula for updating this S value, and this is now based on the new data, which might be higher or lower than what we actually forecasted. So the new value for S will be equal to the alpha smoothing constant for the series, as we are used to from the Holtz method and double exponential smoothing, multiplied by the new value of the demand, divided by the seasonal factor for that particular period. And the book also use T minus N here. I'm not sure if that is mathematically correct either. But what is important here is that you should have the T and the T minus N should be the same period. If you are making a forecast for January, you should use the seasonal factor for January. This is what is important, because these T's, they can be, well, a very high value. It could be if you are forecasting for many months into the future. It's not necessary. Well, it could be 25 or whatever. And if you are talking about months, then 25 will be similar to the seasonal factor for period number one, because 25 will still be January in 2 years in advance. What is important, this T and this T minus N, or this seasonal factor, should be for the same period as this particular demand here. And this is now the importance of the last value of the demand multiplied by the alpha smoothing constant, and then 1 minus alpha will tell us about the importance of the last forecast. And the last forecast is similar to S of T minus 1 plus G of T minus 1, like this. So this is what happened. We have now, in period 0 here, made a forecast based on the current value of the series and the current value of the gradient. And this value, adjusted by the seasonal factor, tells us that we should have a demand which is at this point in period number, let's now see, period number one, in the next period. Then we could get actual demand, which was up here, which tells us that the demand was much higher than we forecasted in this period. This means the value of the series should be adjusted, the value of the gradient should be adjusted, and also the value of the seasonal factor should be adjusted. So what will happen is, since this value is higher than the forecasted value, but this seasonal line, or the series line, will increase more than what we have expected to do. This will also mean that the G value, the gradient, will be higher than the previous one, because this line has a higher gradient, a higher slope, than this line. The last demand tells us to adjust both the value of the series and the value of the gradient, because it will be higher than what we expected. And this is what is happening now here. The value of the series in period number one, in this case, will be the importance of the last data point, which is the alpha value, the seasonal factor, or the smoothing constant alpha, multiplied by the demand adjusted by dividing by the seasonal factor, plus 1 minus alpha multiplied by the previous forecast, or at least the previous calculated value of the series. So this is now the formula to update the series value, and we have a similar formula for updating the gradient, the g of t, which will use the other smoothing constant called beta, multiplied by the difference of the last two series values. We need to calculate the S value before the G value, and then we get an S value for the current period, this one, and we have to find the difference between this value and the previous value, which is this one. This is now the new gradient, and here we have a quite high slope. So the beta smoothing constant will tell us about the importance of the new slope compared to the previous one. So 1 minus beta should be multiplied by the previous value of the gradient. So this is the two formulas for updating the S and the G values, but still we have one more parameter which needs to be updated here, and that's the seasonal parameter. And the seasonal parameter is the C parameter, and this new value here, which was higher than the previous or the forecasted one, could also indicate that the seasonal factors are changing. This product could now maybe sell a bit more in the low season than it was used to be earlier. So this could indicate that the consumers might change their habit and maybe are buying this product more in the low season than they actually had have done earlier. So we also need to update the factor, the seasonal factor here, and this is now done by the third smoothing constant, the gamma. And the gamma will now be the demand for period number t, the new demand, divided by the new value of the series. The new demand, which was this one, divided by the new value of the series, which was this one. Because this will tell us about the seasonal factor, how much would you expect in this particular period compared to what is the general trend. So gamma, the third smoothing constant, should now be multiplied by the new demand, the actual data point, divided by the calculated value of the series, the end point of the line here. And again, as we are used to, we will have the smoothing constant, which is the importance of the last value, but we also need to include 1 minus the smoothing constant, gamma in this case, and multiplied by the previous value of this particular seasonal factor, C of, it's also called a T minus N, because this is the term they use in the textbook. At least this should be the same season as this one. And we can now find a formula for forecasting based on these parameters, the series value, the gradient value, and the seasonal factor. So the forecast from period T to period T plus this Greek letter tau, which is how many periods in advance you are forecasting, will now be equal to the value of the series plus the value of the gradient multiplied by this tau. So if you are forecasting for more than one period ahead, you need to include the number of periods here. Otherwise, this will be 1. If you are forecasting for the next period, the tau value will be 1. So this one, S plus the series plus the gradient in a given number of period, should be multiplied by the seasonal factor for the period you want to forecast for. And you could also add a minus n here, as the textbook does. It doesn't actually make it more mathematically correct, because this, well, as mentioned, what is important is that this seasonal factor is the same as the seasonal factor you are forecasting for. So what we will do, find the point, the series point, add a given number of periods of the same gradient as we have calculated, and adjust by the seasonal factor, which is a percentage on how much over or under the trend line you expect to sell in that particular period you are making the forecast for. So these are now the formulas to use in Winter's method for making a forecast, which both considers the trend and also seasons. So we'll take a break, and we'll continue in the 15 minutes on how to initialize, how to find initial values for these parameters, and then we will also go through one particular example on this.